Gen 4 reactor design concepts, and then on core design and neutronics, so I propose to combine them together. Approximately, it will be in 1.5 hours plus questions and answers. So I will give other lectures this afternoon about neutronics of advanced reactors. In particular, we will talk about Monte Carlo method, and on Friday about safety of fast reactors. Okay, we start with the history. We already had few lectures, some good overview, but just to, when we talk about generation four, I would like to mention that it started with generation one as early prototypes, then it go to generation two, large-scale power stations, and most of the current nuclear power plants belongs to generation two, and then we have evolutionary development, evolutionary designs, which were generation three and three plus. Generation four we called innovative, sometimes revolutionary design, sometimes next evolutionary steps. So in order to address the challenge of generation four reactors, the Generation Four International Forum, or shortly GIF, was created as a cooperative international endeavor. It was organized to carry out the research and development needed to establish the feasibility and performance of the next generation nuclear energy systems. So a number of countries listed here. So it's Argentina, Brazil, Canada, France, Japan, Korea, South Africa, UK, and US. They signed the initial GIF charter in 2001. Next year, Switzerland. The country I represent joined in 2002. Next year, Euratom. So it was the only partner, the only participant of GIF, which is not the country, but the group of countries. It's Euratom, a representative of Euratom, 2003. And then in 2006, two countries, important countries, China and Russia. And the last member was Australia 2 years ago. So at the very beginning in 2001, the people, the experts selected six systems for this exercise, for this evaluation. So they are listed here. And you can see that some of these reactors are considered both in fast and thermal neutron spectrum options. So we plan today now to go through these concepts, and I would like to give you a bit, I tried to put it as a story, so one after another, to put some logics in while presenting these reactors. So here is the concept pictures. Again, with the red frame, I marked fast spectrum, and with the blue frame, the thermal spectrum. And for two systems, you can see that it's both blue and red. But in dashed line, I put kind of backup. So solid line is main. So supercritical water cooled reactor, the thermal option is the main and fastest backup. And for molten salt, I would say it's now fast option is main in GIF, and thermal is optional backup. So the important matrix for the important requirements which were used in GIF from the very beginning, which were applied for development of the system, is this list of four goals. Already mentioned at this school several times. The first one is sustainability. So it's two sides. One side is long-term fuel supply, and the second side is minimization of waste and long-term stewardship burden. The second goal is safety and reliability. So we would like to develop systems which has very low likelihood and degree of core damage. And the goal is to practically eliminate the need for off-site emergency response, which is a very significant challenge. The third goal is economics, so the life cycle cost should have advantage over other energy sources, and financial risk should be comparable to other energy projects. Again, very challenging tasks. And final goal is proliferation resistance and physical protection. So it should be the systems, the mass flows should be unattractive, organized to be unattractive material diversion pathways, and enhance physical protection against terrorism. Okay, when I present you the six systems, I follow this template. So first, I will show you general concept, like the image and main features, and then give you general description, which I called fact sheet, where I present advantages, challenges, designs under development, and reactors under operation. And then for every system, I selected one example to be more specific, to give a little bit more details about the design. And it will be main parameters, reactor fuel, core, balance of plant, and then the final point for every system will be problems from viewpoint of GIF goals. And then we will consider the possible solution and go to the next system. Okay, I'll start with generation three concept, which I would propose to consider as reference. We also use it in our exercise, so it's classical pressurized water reactor. Everybody knows this design, I hope, so I don't go to the details, but as a specific example, I selected EPR with thermal power 4,300 megawatt, efficiency 37%, the primary coolant and moderator light water, pressure is 16 megapascals, inlet-outlet temperature around 300 degrees, neutron spectrum is thermal, and therefore breeding gain is low. And if you look at three goals, so I would like to mention that I'm going to focus on first three goals, first of all, because I'm not an expert in proliferation resistance. So I will look in this lecture at sustainability, safety, reliability, and economics. So from this viewpoint, PWR is good, we would say, good safety, good economics because of the economy of scale. We have a lot of this system. It's already mature technology. But I would qualify goal one as poor because of low breeding gain and low conversion, low rate of generation of new fissile. So from viewpoint of fuel, assembly and core design, so the fuel is classically enriched uranium dioxide, but it can be also mixed to uranium plutonium oxide fuel. It's cylindrical pellet, 1 centimeter height, about 8 millimeter diameter, which is put in the cladding tube made of zircalloy, which is an alloy of zirconium isotope. So the length is about 3 meters. At the top has relatively small, like 20 centimeter fission gas plenum. So then these fuel rods are put in the square assembly. Spacers, grid spacers are used to provide the rigidity and make the distance between fuel rods. And this assembly doesn't have the duct or wrapper, so it provides cross flow between assemblies. Then they are put in the core, as you can see here. And the general, I would say, the core, this core is very homogeneous, so it's good from this viewpoint. In particular, even the control rods are inserted in every fuel assembly. And this is an interesting point because with this design, we should be able to remove all control rods from the core during refueling. And we can do it because we have another way to control reactivity, which is dissolving the boron acid in the water. So this allows us to insert control rods in every fuel assembly and obtain very homogeneous core from this viewpoint. So what are the advantages? It's operational experience and established technologies, of course, which is good for economics. It's light water as a coolant. Well, it's common matter. It's transparent, easy to handle. It's boron control, I mentioned, and yeah, there is more advantages. There are challenges, and the first challenge I would say for safety is high coolant pressure we need, because we have small margin to boiling for water, and in order to receive this efficiency, this economic output, we have to use high coolant pressure, 16 megapascals, and this is a safety issue of depressurization. Loss of coolant accident is design basis accident, which requires a lot of safety systems, analysis, demonstration, and so on. And the second challenge or problem, disadvantage is low breeding or low conversion ratio we already discussed. There is many designs under development. EPR is just one example. And there is this number of reactors under operation. OK, this is the last slide about the PWR. So I repeat here the parameters. So I will do it at, for every system. And I will add columns in order to have, at the end, the overall table for comparison. And with this orange color, I showed a kind of problematic, a kind of the parameters which we would like to improve. So in this case, we have efficiency of 37 and economics, therefore, is good, but it can be improved. So if I ask you the question, how we can increase efficiency? So we take PWR and we would like to improve the efficiency of our cycle. What we can do? Do you have any ideas? Yes. How to go high? What is this most simple step to do? Yes, I like this more. It's simpler. Let's increase the temperature, and we will improve the parameters of the thermal cycle. To increase the temperature, we need to increase what also we just discussed, the margin to boiling. So if we increase the temperature in PW, increase pressure, yes. So increase the water pressure and temperature, and we arrive to supercritical water-cooled reactor, which operates, which indeed increases the pressure, and even above the thermodynamic critical point of water, which is 374 degrees centigrade and 22 megapascals. So here I remind you the dependence of pressure on temperature. Here is the critical point, and here we have supercritical fluid, which is neither liquid nor vapor, but something in between. And so the supercritical water-cooled reactor operates both below critical point and above critical point. So why it's good from viewpoint of economics? Because we can apply existing advanced supercritical water technology used in coal plants. Very well developed, it's working. Okay, this is an attempt. Let's combine the PWR technology with supercritical water technology. And let's use direct one-through steam cycle. So no steam generator, no steam separators and dryers. This all can potentially make the system better from economical point of view. Okay, advantages. It's based on Gen 3 plus reactor technology. It merges this technology with advanced supercritical water technology. It's high efficiency than Gen 3 plus. It's possible to have both thermal and fast spectrum. I will show you later the density, and we will see that at these conditions, the density can go very low. And this, we have steam, and this, in principle, allows us intermediate fast, even fast spectrum option. And I mentioned that there are two options considered for supercritical water-cooled reactor. challenges, of course, high pressure, high temperature materials, water chemistry and radiolysis, then thermal hydraulics, because for this high pressure, there are gaps in our knowledge of heat transfer and critical flow databases. Safety demonstration. So in case of fast spectrum, we have or can have positive void effect as in any fast spectrum, but also high pressure assumes potentially more violent, probably loss of coolant accident and things like this. And fuel qualification, again, high pressure, high temperature. So we cannot use Circaloy anymore. Designs under development, this the example I will show you, it's high performance light water reactor developed in frame of European project. There are no reactors under operation as far as I know. So here I put the first column, which is now new, the first generation for system specific design HPLWR 2300 megawatt thermal efficiency 44, okay, increase. We reached the goal, we improved the efficiency, we improved the economics. So I put here the green arrow up, it means improved compared to PWR. Primary coolant remains water, and you can see how much the delta temperature is increased. So it's now, instead of 31 degree, around 30 delta T in PWR, we have 220 degrees in this, and it goes up to 500 degrees. And the pressure is 25. We still have breeding gain low. We didn't improve because this is an option of thermal spectrum. And I highlighted and marked in red the problems. So water at this pressure and at this temperature definitely is very corrosive, very aggressive against structural materials. Specific design, okay. The I started to say that we have delta T, which is 220 degrees. And if you take into account the uncertainties, not uncertainties, but the power distribution and local peaking factors, that then for this high delta T, the local peak cladding temperature can go too high, unacceptably high. And the target is now 630. degrees. So we need, so people looked for a design solution to solve this problem, to limit the peak cladding temperature. And possible solution, as far as I know, also used in coal plants, is organized heating in three steps. So, and it's illustrated here. It's a bit complicated design. It was fun for me to learn it, so I will try to explain it quickly as far as I can. So the idea is that the inlet feed water in enters the circuit and divided in two parts. One half goes down, one half goes up. So down goes along the down camera, low plenum, and then enters the core. And the core circulation is organized not in the usual way when everything goes up, but for the part of the core, water, supercritical water goes up and heated up in evaporator, then mixed at upper mixing chamber, then goes down through superheat one, mixed in the lower mixing chamber, and then go up through superheat two, in order to go out through core outlet chamber. So the idea is that we organize very good mixing after each step. After evaporator, everything is mixed, and so we remove the local overheating because of the power non-uniformity. And we do it two times, an upper mixing chamber and lower mixing chamber. This allows, according to calculation, to keep the peak cladding temperature at 630, but of course we significantly deteriorate the potential for natural circulation. Power also reducing at each step. I mean, at evaporator, it's higher than at superheat 1 and superheat 2. I will show you how it is organized. So there is also dedicated water boxes. You can see here the design of the assembly. Sorry. Design of the assembly, so it's square assembly, and there is a water box in the middle, which is independent circuit, and we have, it's called water boxes, and we have there the relatively cool, cold water, which serves as moderator. Okay, complicated. Reactor vessel even more complicated. Okay, I put here some interesting design solutions. So there are four lines to enter for feed water, and then it goes down and up. So down it's core inlet, and here we have upper plenum from where relatively cold water enters water boxes. The three examples of channels shown is evaporator, superheat 1, superheat 2. What else? We have here interesting device, which is backflow limiter, which is using the swirl in order to have much higher hydraulic resistance in backward flow compared to direct flow. And we are considering this device now for European sodium fast reactor. For similar purposes. And we also, the important design feature is that the vessel is contacting only cold water, only feed water temperature. The wall thickness is 45 centimeters here, which is huge. Okay, so for the core design, I already showed the assembly. It uses wire wrap, like in a sodium fast reactor, to keep fuel rods together. It's closed channels with a wrapper wall. The evaporator superheat and superheat 2 is organized as shown here. So it's the same number of clusters, 52 clusters. For every channel, and one cluster is four assemblies, and then evaporator in the center, it means higher power, and then lower power. This is a balance of plant concept, so I don't go into details because I don't understand it, I just copied, and it's very complicated, as you can see, and I guess very optimized because it's real. Balance of plant used in coal plants. And the efficiency is, yeah, like 44%. Okay, this is a summary for supercritical water reactors, so which emphasizes, so I don't repeat, but I emphasize the problem. It's water at high temperature and decrease of safety and reliability, I would say, compared to PWR, because we increased the pressure and temperature, it creates a problem both for safety and reliability. So now the question for this system, so how to keep high efficiency, improve economics, still we would like to keep it, but at the same time avoid problems related to water at high pressure and temperature, so improve safety and reliability. Yes, which coolant? Yes. Another coolant, because it's not what we have here under the whiteboard. Gas, inert gas. So, okay. We have active, from viewpoint of corrosion, we have water at high temperature. But if you replace the water with inert gas, then we don't have the problem of corrosion anymore. And we arrive at very high temperature reactor, which uses graphite as moderator and helium as a coolant. So, and we consider both graphite prismatic and pebble bed as reference configurations. And the one of the most important feature of high temperature reactor is very low power density. It's like factor of few tens, like 30 times lower than in PWR. And this is a basis of very good safety of this reactor, of this concept. So advantages: high temperature enables non-electric applications and high efficiency. But I already mentioned the safety, and the, this reactor is designed so safe that they call it walk-away safety. So you just don't do anything and walk away or run away, and the reactor shut down itself, in fact. Even in case when helium is completely lost because of reactivity feedbacks, it shut down itself and it removes decay heat through the vessel by radiation and natural convection of atmospheric air. Impressive. And advantages inert gas coolant, we already discussed. Challenges. So one challenge is in the first world, which is very high temperature reactor. And it means that we need to reach temperature of 1,000 degrees which for hydrogen production. I mean, non-electric application. One of the non-electric application is hydrogen production. And in fact, this gray plant is depicted the hydrogen production. But also, coupling with process heat applications. And important challenge we should remember is graphite as a waste. So the big amount of graphite means we irradiate it. At the end, we will have a big pile of irradiated graphite, which is a red waste. Designs under development, Chinese, HTR, PM, and reactors under operation, Japanese, HTTR. And I selected this Chinese design as an example because I have nice animation. So I put now V in a brackets. It means that it's not necessarily very high temperature. It's still here, it's still generation four system, but it's not 1,000, it's 750 degrees, which is huge and which gives us an efficiency of 45%, which is comparable to, or even slightly better than supercritical water reactor. Helium, 7 megapascal pressure, moderator graphite, neutron spectral thermal, means breeding gain is low. Sustainability, I put question mark because it's probably worse than for PWR because we produce this additional large amount of activated graphite. But it's question mark, I don't insist. So otherwise, it's, I would say, one of the perfect systems, except sustainability. So considering fuel, it uses, this design uses fuel pebbles, which have inside trisulcoated particles, which consist of the UO2 kernel, and then several layers of porous carbon or paralytic carbon, silicon carbide, and so on. So very high inertia of this, very low density. So this 6 centimeter diameter pebble contains about 7 gram heavy metal. So very diluted. And it contains about 12,000 coated particle, this pebble. Fuel loading scheme is multipass. Every pebble goes through reactor 6 times. And this animation shows how it is mixed. So it's first just shown for illustration, these lines, the position. And then when it goes second time back, then it's somehow more uniformly distributed. We try, the master student tried to simulate this explicitly. And with Serpent also, this kind of operation. And average discharge burn-up is 90 megawatt day per kilogram uranium, which is relatively high compared to PW. Okay, this is a reactor. It's relatively classical gas-cooled reactor with reactor vessel and power conversion system, which holds steam generator. So the fuel pebbles inserted from above and discharged from below. yes, there is a graphite reflector and there is a containment circulation here. They also consider two reactors connected to a single steam turbine and the power density 3.3 megawatt per cubic meter, which is factor of 30, as I already mentioned, lower compared to PWR. High thermal inertia, huge thermal inertia, makes it this reactor walk away safe. Okay, so here is the summary, the only, as I mentioned, we have breeding gain below zero and sustainability, and this is the weakness of PWR, supercritical VHTR, all thermal system. So it's difficulty to fulfill goal number one, sustainability. And the question here, how to reach this, and in particular improved fuel utilization, it's probably trivial. Yeah, develop the design, change the design to obtain the fast neutron spectrum, and we arrive here to gas-cooled fast reactors. So we still gas-cooled, but now we remove moderator, no moderator. Keep helium coolant, we keep pressure, 7 megapascals. And both direct and indirect cycle were considered. This is direct cycle with Brighton machine. But later, GIF project decided to focus on indirect cycle. So what is the advantages? Potential for new fissile breeding due to fast neutron spectrum and better red waste treatment. It's transparent and inert coolant. It's high efficiency. And the challenges, the first and most important challenge is safety demonstration. Safety issues exist. In particular, decay heat removal in case of loss of flow and depressurization accidents. And the difference between HTR, very safe, and GFR, which is not so safe, is that there is no moderator. There is not this huge amount of material which gives thermal inertia. And now we have like bare core, which is fuel with some cladding, but it very low thermal, has very low thermal inertia compared to HTR. And this is the issue. And then high temperature materials and fuel qualification. Because we could not use these TRISO particles, things like this. We need some new materials like probably silicon carbide, which is more acceptable for to provide fast spectrum. Design sounder development, it's Allegro 75 originally, now they go down. I don't know exactly to what, 50 probably. And more large power design is GCFR of 2400 megawatt thermal. There is no reactors under operation. So I summarize here, I present here the specific design, which is GCFR, the big reactor, 2400, the efficiency of 45, very good. Helium, so inlet, outlet temperature is 400, 780, 7 megapascals, no moderator, fast spectrum. Breeding gain is close to zero, means isobreeder, and sustainability now we have good, but safety we definitely deteriorate compared to PWR, and with economics we could not say much. Most likely it will be very poor from viewpoint of economics. So I put here the red code because of depressurization accident, and this is low thermal inertia because there is no moderator. So the fuel of this design, one of the options, so developed at CEA is carbide fuel, mixed carbide fuel in sandwich cladding, so-called sandwich cladding, because they started with silicon carbide cladding, or SiC-SiC, they call it SiC-SiC because there is some reinforced fibers inside the SiC matrix in order to improve the the stability or robustness of this cladding, because SiC is relatively fragile. There is no plastic limits for this material. Moreover, in CEA they propose some metallic liner in the middle of this cladding, because during operation they expect that SiC becomes relatively porous because of microcracking, and the fission products will migrate through the cladding. And to avoid this, they consider the very thin metallic liner from refractory metal like tungsten. And the problem here that these all refractory metals are very good neutron absorbers, so it will impact significantly neutronics. Moreover, they consider buffer bond between silicon between carbide fuel and cladding, which is a kind of carbon-based braid. This kind of stuff, very exotic. I think the reason was that the carbide has very high swelling rate under irradiation, and this makes makes dangerous the contact and pellet cladding mechanical interaction. So to facilitate these regimes, they considered buffer bond. The core, probably nothing special here. Two zones of plutonium content. Control assemblies. Well, I discuss it a little bit later. The only interesting feature you can note is that there are two fission gas plenums above and below, and the reason is that it's nearly impossible to make a cladding of SiC, of silicon carbide, as long as we need, like, I don't know, 2 meters or 3 meters. And they designed this core with kind of two fuel rods on top of each other. So with fission, one rod has fission plenum, gas plenum above, and second below. It's just exotic stuff for this core. So the reactor looks like this. Again, it's relatively classic configuration with reactor vessel, but now we have not one, but three main power conversion loop, which hosts the intermediate heat exchanger, and also three decay heat removal loop dedicated to decay heat removal in case of accidents. And well, this creates also the potential danger of mistakes with closure and opening of the valves, because this will require reconfiguration of the circulation in case of accidents. Another feature which can make this design very expensive is spherical guard vessel. I will show you later also some. But the idea is to put additional vessel in order to guarantee the backup pressure in case of depressurization events. Okay, this is big balance of plant concept. You see the reactor vessel, the heat exchanger, so circulator, main blower, the temperatures. Then we have decay heat loop, which is includes the water, some water pool, and the circulation of water for decay heat removal. It should work fine. If we shut down the reactor, then we can remove decay heat. But the problem is when we have the break of the any of the pipes, then we have depressurization. And that's why this guard vessel is introduced, in order to guarantee the backup pressure, to still be able to remove decay heat in depressurization event. Moreover, there is a kind of emergency cooling system like in PWR, but in this case, it's heavy gas, which is injected when needed. And this heavy gas was selected to be nitrogen, So there is three reservoirs inside guard vessel with nitrogen at 14 bars, which is also not something very good. So it's a lot of potential energy inside guard vessel, which can kind of explode or behave somehow, not good for safety. Okay, then there is a power conversion system shown here with turbines, some water circuit here. Yes, there is DHR blower, so the DHR system is not fully passive. It uses the blower. Okay, and inside guard vessel also there is not nitrogen at atmospheric pressure. So there are several ideas how to improve the safety of gas fast reactor. So one idea is it's all around decay heat removal under depressurized condition. This is a key safety issue for gas fast reactor. One idea is we don't have coolant or moderator thermal inertia. Let's think how to replace this with mechanical inertia. Okay, so and this one idea is let's put the blower on the same shaft as a compressor and turbine. So then we have a very big momentum from turbine and the blower will have very slow coast down. Okay, nice idea, but I expect that it could create some bad feedback during normal operation. Another idea is to improve the passivity and the replace or complement the decay heat removal loop with DHR blower with another design of DHR loop which using the Brighton machine, which practically will use decay heat to remove decay heat. Okay, so there is no active components. There is still the need to run the machine, to start up it. And this is a separate question. Two examples of the directions of safety improvement for gas fast reactor. Okay, this is a summary for gas fast reactor where I emphasize the problem. So it's high pressure, relatively 7 megapascals, no moderator, low thermal inertia, and therefore the deterioration of goal 2, which is safety and reliability. So we have low thermal inertia, repeating requiring special safety measures against core meltdown in case of depressurization events. So the question is how to improve what we can do to improve the safety. What is the next step we can do? Yes, very high thermal energy. So very high thermal inertia of graphite moderator make transient slow. It's removed from the surface of the vessel by radiation and natural convection of atmospheric air. But the second point is very low power density of HTR compared to GFR. So in GFR, we have compact core with very high power density. HTR is very big, it's very low power density. Both can operate with natural convection, yes. So what we can do to improve the situation? Yes? Yes. Let's try. Use liquid metal instead of gas. And we write that sodium cooled fast reactor. And this is a concept. So it's a pool type reactor, which is traditional for Europe, where all components of primary system is immersed in the big pool of sodium, very big inertia now because of the coolant. We didn't have in case of helium. Good potential for natural convection. Here we can see that it has an intermediate circuit, and it uses, in this case, steam water cycle. So the advantages, again, it's potential for new fissile breeding due to fast neutron spectrum and better treatment of red wastes. It's excellent thermal conductivity of sodium. This is very efficient cooling. That's why it was selected as a coolant in the first fast reactors, because sodium is the best from viewpoint of thermal conductivity from all available materials. Large margin to boiling in sodium cooled fast reactors, it means no pressurization required. Very important improvement compared to all previous considered reactors. I mean, GFR, HTR, and supercritical water reactors. Significant operational experience, it's more than 300 reactor years. At the same time, challenges, chemical activity of sodium when in contact with water or air, and this requires intermediate circuit, which has impact on economy, makes systems more expensive. Significant scattering cross-section of sodium, it means that when we remove sodium, then the spectrum will become harder. And this means positive reactivity effect. It's simple. If you remember the eta dependence in high energy region for plutonium, for example, plutonium 9, then it's quite steeply increasing. It means when we shift in the fast region, when we shift spectrum, it becomes harder. Then the ratio of production and absorption becomes better, and it means positive reactivity effect. And it means we need special safety measures to protect our reactor for this case, for the case of sodium disappearance. And one of the most probably possible event is sodium boiling, but it's not the only one. The gas entrainment is another example. So designs under development, India, PFBR, BN1200 Russia, France is Astrid, and European sodium fast reactor in Europe. Reactors under operation is three reactors in Russia and CEFR in China. That's it, as far as I know. I forgot something. Oh, small one. Yes. Okay, thank you. We'll let. So now this is our table with last column for SFR, where I emphasize the problem is, which is sodium itself and which is the reactive with, in interaction with water and air. So safety and reliability compared to PWR, yeah, I could not say. So something is better, something is worse. And economics most likely is still not competitive. It's still with SFR in general, probably we can classify as more expensive as PWR. So for fuel rod and fuel subassembly, it's mixed uranium plutonium dioxide as a fuel and stainless steel as cladding. It's classically hexagonal lattice of rods fixed with helicoil wire spacers, closed assembly, so no cross flows between sub assemblies, but important inter-assembly flow, which is quite challenging for simulation. Absorbers are inserted in the dedicated assemblies, which creates heterogeneity of the core. You remember I emphasized that PWR is quite homogeneous and control elements are inserted in every assembly. This could not be done in sodium fast reactor because during refueling, absorbers should remain in the core because we don't have boron regulation. And that means that we need special channels for absorber to allow the refueling, the extraction of fuel subassemblies. That's why we have dedicated channels, dedicated assemblies for absorber. And we need also the special design at the inlet of every assembly in order to redistribute properly the sodium flow rate between very hot assemblies and relatively cold assemblies like fuel and absorber assemblies. So it requires more complicated design of the core compared to pressurized water reactor. We have fuel stack of about 1 meter with helium inside the fuel rod and the large about 1 meter fission gas plenum below the fuel. Anybody knows why it's below the fuel? Why it's not above? Yes, classically it's below because we'd like to gas pressure inside the fuel rod to be low. We don't want to heat up the gas inside, and the big gas plenum is heated by sodium. So we would like to contact gas plenum with colder sodium, not with hotter. So if you put it above, then the gas pressure will be significantly higher from by definition because it's hotter. So I use a European sodium fast reactor, which is developed now. It's a long story from SPX2, then EFR, then CPSFR. Now we have a project where we develop update the design of European sodium fast reactor. So here you can see the radial core layout, but it's quite nice. I like it. It's perfectly symmetric. It has 6 batches, 6-year fuel cycle. It uses mixed scheme. It means there is no reshuffling. And every year we remove the fuel assemblies of one color and put the new ones. And then it's kind of changing every year. There is internal storage here for 50% of the core. And there are also new feature, which is corium discharge tubes. We will talk later on Friday in more details about this. Why do we need corium discharge tubes? And also all DSD rods, which is a SCRAM system, the all drive lines equipped with passively activated QD point locks, which release the absorber in case of temperature increase because of this QD effect. And it inserted by gravity. So the axial core layout, there is inner zone, outer zone. The feature here that they have the same height, but the different bottom height. So we use the same plutonium content, but different height. In the center, in the inner zone, it's shorter. At the outer zone, the fissile is higher. There is also a layer of blanket below, and there is a steel blanket, and this is a fission gas plenum. This is a control rod assemblies and corium discharge tubes. Yes, plutonium content is about 18% currently. Then this shows the global view from above. You can see the 6 loops, so intermediate and secondary loops. So 6 intermediate heat exchangers in yellow, 3 primary pumps. Yes, and in every box we have 6 modular steam generators. But it's quickly the overall design. So we have 3 decay heat removal systems shown here, but again, we will discuss, I will present it in more details on Friday. So the primary system looks like this. We have, we propose here to eliminate the second vessel because we can improve in this way significantly economics and replace the safety vessel with metallic liner on the surface of the insulator. So that's one of the proposal which can be interesting. There is a corium, there is a core catcher inside vessel which we analyze, make thermal calculations now. The goal is to design it to host 100% of fissile, but I think it's not possible. But it's under development. So this is in vessel fuel handling system. It's, yeah, I put it here, but there is nothing special. It just illustrates that with 2 rotating plugs, we can reach every fuel assemblies and we can move it into the internal fuel storage and then it can be removed from internal fuel storage and put outside of the reactor. Pit cooling, so reactor pit is cooled by 2 systems, oil system and water system, and it should be also, they are under forced convection. And then this is one of the, this is auxiliary, I would say, decay heat removal system, which can be used in case if needed, but normally it is used for cooling down the concrete. This is secondary system which shows 1 decay heat removal dedicated. It's connected to IHX, so it doesn't have separate heat exchanger. This is also the new measure we propose. So it should remove decay heat even in the case when we completely lose the secondary system. And we also consider to remove decay heat from the surface of steam generator. That's why we put this 6 modular steam generator in a box, in a casing. And when you open windows and atmospheric air circulates here and remove some decay heat from the surface of steam generators. Thermal pump is a nice concept which is using thermal electricity in order to provide some additional pump head to contribute to natural convection. And we will also discuss it on Friday. This is a balance of plant concept which shows decay heat removal system, the first, second, and the third, some parameters of the like inlet, outlet, which is very classical, like in Super Phoenix, the tertiary water is at 185 bars. Okay, this is a summary of the SFR concept, where I put a kind of problematic points, issues is sodium itself and safety and economics. And now the question is, although SFR is definitely the most mature concepts among generation 4 fast reactors. However, we have the problems. The weakness is the risk of sodium water and sodium air reaction and corresponding design complication, for example, intermediate loop. So how to improve the safety and reliability and economics and keep at the same time the sustainability. So what is the next step you can propose? Yes. Molten lead. Yes. Well, it's, yeah, you know how to do it now. How to find out. But yes, so people are proposing, expert proposing, let's consider another liquid metal instead of sodium. either lead, bismuth, or lead. And in generation 4 international forum, the reference system is lead-cooled fast reactor, and this shows the concept. So as you can see, there is no intermediate circuit anymore. So there is steam generator is inside the primary pool. In this case, it uses Brayton cycle, but it's probably not the reference, it's just concept. And the features, we can mention simplicity, no intermediate circuit. And the complication is that oxygen control should be provided for materials protection. So what are the advantages of lead-cooled fast reactor? Okay, potential, the fast spectrum is breeding, okay, as for other fast reactors. High density, so this is a really very big thermal inertia, which makes all transients smooth. So in a way, it's similar to what we have is in HTR, but now we have fast reactor, we have here the high power density. High thermal conductivity, not as high as in the case of sodium, but still it's liquid metal, and high expansion coefficient makes very efficient heat removal at low velocity and high natural circulation level. So lead is relatively passive with water and air. I mean the quick, the fast interaction. So it allows to eliminate intermediate circuit. And it has large margin to boiling. The boiling is 1740 degrees, which is well above the cladding melting point. So in any case, this big margin means that no pressurization required, of course. It can operate at atmospheric pressure above the free level. Challenges, there is a number of challenges. The lead has very high density. It means problem with erosion, seismic issues, and refueling issues. Because when we need to insert something in this huge pool of lead, it requires a technology to do it. At high temperature, structural materials such as iron or nickel are slowly dissolving in lead flow. So this is called corrosion. And this is the problem number one of lead-cooled fast reactor, which requires protection, which requires special technology. And one of the technology I mentioned is oxygen control, developed in Russia, in IPP, in particular for lead bismuth reactor for submarines. It was efficient, it works, but it's quite complicated because you should control the oxygen content in a relatively narrow corridor, and this oxygen allows to create on the surface of cladding a very thin and strong layer of oxide, which protects the dissolution of stainless steel components in the liquid lead. There are other solutions or attempts to use dedicated layers, liners on the surface to protect this effect. Okay, we still have high void reactivity effect, which exists in all fast reactors. But now we don't have the boiling of lead as a potential danger. Okay, we have it, but it will be quite late. Well, serious, severe accident when we have already melting of the cladding and so on. So, but we have potential of gas entry, for example. Which gas can enter in the core, then we can have big positive reactivity insertion. And another challenge is low margin to freezing, which is 327 degrees. Okay, it's exactly 600 Kelvin, easy to remember. And this is relatively low, so the special measures are needed in order to avoid the freezing and in order to mitigate the freezing in case if it happens. So it should be some very powerful electrical heaters, things like this. designs under development quite a lot. There is European lead fast reactor, which is big option. There is Alfred, which is small demonstration reactor. There is Russian designed Brest OD-300. There is American S-Star, and the list is not complete. There is no reactors under operation, very small operational experience. I mentioned military applications, summaries. So summary, so this shows the parameters of Alfred, which I selected as example. Alfred is European lead fast reactor demonstration project of 300 megawatt thermal power, high efficiency lead as a coolant with these temperatures 400-480 degrees. So the problem I already mentioned, and pressure I put a little bit higher because we have gravitational head, so it's not insignificant in the core, but it's still, there is no pressurization. And limited operational experience we can mention as a problem, as a deficiency of this design compared to sodium fast reactor. So fuel subassembly, it's a hexagonal lattice with wire spacer in closed wrapper. And the feature is that there is no refueling mechanism. So the fuel subassembly looks like this. This is like traditional subassembly. This is the bottom, this is the top. But then we have the upper shroud and ballast, which allows us to have access from the top to the subassembly. In a way, we have like a refueling driveline or refueling mechanism connected to every subassembly during normal operation. And this ballast, which is some very heavy material, like tungsten or something like this, allows to avoid the flowing up of the subassembly due to buoyancy. Okay, some design details. This is a core. Well, here we don't have anything special, so it's inner zone, outer zone, with different plutonium content, control rod, safety rods. Primary system, so no rotational plugs in reactor roof because we don't have refueling machine, so we can take every subassembly and remove it. Reactivity control by two diverse and redundant systems. Primary system configuration is pool type, enhanced natural convection in accident conditions because of the good properties of lead, but also this very simple design, very simple configuration. Mechanical primary pumps at hot leg, which is minus of the design, I would say. Put here, again, to simplify the circulation, just very simple, it goes up and then down, and that's it. Decay heat removal, for decay heat removal, they designed isolation condenser connected to deep coolers with straight double-walled tubes. Two vessels, reactor vessel and safety vessel. Yes, balance of plant concept, okay, shows main temperatures and 8 steam generators. So we have water, 180 bar pressurized water inside the primary vessel, which requires some measures and demonstration of safety. So DHR condenser, that's main features. And finally, this is the conclusion for Alfred. And here the question, more general probably, I would like to ask. So in all considered systems, the accidents with core meltdown has extremely low probability, but they are still possible. And do we have the idea how to practically eliminate the core meltdown. Melted before, yes. Yes. Increase safety margin. No, it's not practical elimination. So the only way to practically eliminate something is to do it before. Like a bit for me, I consider reactor pool, sodium fast reactor of pool type, because inside we have still the pipes. But when we look at this pool, we can say, okay, we already realized the pipe break. And you can imagine that the sodium goes out and fill this big pool. Okay, we eliminated the pipe break accident in this way. And here is something similar to eliminate meltdown of solid fuel. Let's design the reactor with liquid fuel. And here we already mentioned during this lecture several times, and later we will have dedicated lecture about molten salt, so I will be very quick here. So the picture of the official picture of generation 4 is thermal concept shown here, and you can see one of the interesting feature immediately that there is a freeze plug and then some emergency dump tanks. So it means that in a passive way, so freeze plug is probably the frozen salt, another salt, which will melt down at increased temperature, and then there will be the path for molten salt, fuel molten salt, to go down in the safe configuration, properly cooled, and so on. So it's kind of protection against accidents, which is peculiar for molten salt reactor. But here I modified the thermal concept by putting this big yellow rectangle in the middle, which illustrates the idea of the fast molten salt reactor, which is just big empty space filled with molten salt with fuel dissolved, which allows us to have critical configuration, critical reactor with fast or intermediate fast spectrum. Okay, it's a very long discussion of advantages and challenges. I'll probably go quickly through. We have fast spectrum. This is advantage. We have large margin to boiling. We can operate at atmospheric pressure. Very important for safety. Strongly negative fuel salt density, reactivity effect or void effect. So, of course, when we reduce the density of salt, we reduce the density of fuel, and it's strong negative effect. So this is probably the only reactor, only fast reactor, which has intrinsically negative void effect or coolant density effect. High efficiency because the temperature is high, no structural material, so it's apart from the vessel. If you look at the core, there is no structural material. It's homogeneous core. It means there is no radiation damage and associated problems. So there is a possibility to add or remove fuel salt and simpler reprocessing, which is big topic. What are the advantages of molten salt reactor from viewpoint of reprocessing, which I don't touch in here. Also, natural feature very good is possibility to continuously remove insoluble fission products, in particular gaseous fission products, which is quite significant part of the absorber, which can be removed and stored separately from the core, which is probably good news for molten salt reactor. Challenges, first of all, is strong corrosiveness of molten salt fuels. Then lack of usual barriers like fuel cladding. It means that the new safety approach should be developed in order to show, for example, as I mentioned, the fission gases are removed from the core, and this gives some new safety philosophy because we separate isotopes in all other reactors in traditional solid fuel reactors. The fission gases are stored inside the fuel rods, and sometimes for many years. So they stored together with the spent fuel. And in case of molten salt, it gives us possibility to separate and probably store different isotopes in a different places or separated. This is also a big topic for discussion, how to create this new safety approach, new safety architecture. So, of course, high fluence on vessel. The problem, part of fuel is always outside the core because it circulates through heat exchanger, and it means that we need larger fuel inventory for criticality, and we have reduced fraction of delayed neutrons, which is an issue for safety, requires safety demonstration. Low margin to freezing, similarly to lead reactor, should be addressed. Low or unknown solubility of compounds formed during operation. So it's a big issue from viewpoint of chemistry, solubility of even very, very exotic probably isotopes. We don't have database for this. Designs under development, a very long list. One of the last slides I will show you the three. We try to classify different designs, and I will show you one proposal. And there is no reactors under operation. So MSRE in Oak Ridge is the only database for operational, with operational experience. So an example I show you here is molten salt fast reactor developing European project EVOL, and then some of our ongoing now. So here you can see the core, which is an empty space. It's open volume with shape optimized for fluid dynamics. So around the core there is 16 recirculation loops. Each includes the pipes, bubble separator, bubble injection pump, and heat exchanger. And globally, like there are three circuits: so fuel circuit, intermediate circuit, which is still nozzle salt without fuel, and then energy conversion system based on probably steam water cycle, and draining tanks shown here. This is a balance of plant concept, basically very simplified to show you, in particular, the level of temperatures. So it's 700, 800. So it's very high temperature reactor. Finally, that's what I promised you. It's just to show that it's kind of jungle. There is huge number currently. A lot of interest in molten salt reactor, a lot of ideas, a lot of students and young engineers working on different aspects. So we try to put it in some matrix. This is an attempt. Okay, this is a summary. Finally, we have the whole table with six GIF systems and PWR. So we briefly considered them. I would like to emphasize that the goal was to discuss some advantages and challenges and not to rank the designs. But nevertheless, I put here the examples. So it's examples selected by me. There are other systems, but here I put some specific parameters and emphasize kind of where I see the problems of these reactors, where R&D is currently focused, and where is the direction of improvement. Well, last slide, I just as a bonus, I put here the plot of density as a function of temperature, and I put here six systems. In fact, six coolants like lead, molten salt, sodium, water at two pressures, and helium. And I showed the operational ranges for every examples of GIF systems. And you can see the level of temperature, margins to boiling, margins to freezing, the changes of density at inlet and outlet. For example, for supercritical, you can see that the changes is very big in water density. It reminds a little bit boiling water reactor, but it is not. It's a supercritical water reactor. So this chart can be instructive and contains a lot of information. Okay, these are references, and that's it. Thank you for your attention.